Now this. And that, kids, is why you don't mix iron dust and sun cream.
Hi, it's Todd of Todd's Workshop and Todd Cutler here. And today we're going to come back to look at the shield again, actually. And this is in response to quite a lot of your questions, because three main points came up. One, put the shield at an angle, don't shoot it straight on. The other was it should be covered in rawhide. And the third is it should be shot from further away. Now that gives us a fantastic opportunity on the third point there to do some distance testing to see how the power of a longbow drops off over distance. So I'm going to shoot it at 25, 50, 75 and 100 metres, measure the speed of the arrow at point of impact, not of course of leaving, and then we're going to know how much speed and energy is lost from the arrow when it strikes. And what I'll also do is give an approximate angle measurement so that we know how steeply the angle is entering at a given distance. It'll just be a rough guide. Like all of this, it's just a rough guide. It's not absolute science. It's just indicative. It just points us in the right direction to our thinking. Now coming back to the first couple of points, a lot of people said, what is the point of shooting the shield front on? Because obviously, you know, you're going to be deflecting the arrows. Well, that's an interesting point. Now in sword combat, for instance, or if you're fighting an axe or whatever it might be, you are of course angling your shield. You're not taking the arrows as a dead blow. You are driving them away. Now I don't know if any of you have done this, and I'm not suggesting you should, but I have stood at a target with blunt arrows shot at me. At 25 or 30 metres, if you are watching the bowman shoot and it's one arrow, you can step aside from the arrow. That's all right. If you're not watching him, forget it. You've missed your opportunity. If two bowmen shoot, it's like the rabbit in the headlights. Your body hasn't got time to decide whether to go left, right, up or down, and you're shot. And the thing is, if you are in the front lines of a body of men and the arrows are coming in, you can't see them, you can't dodge them, they're just coming. So what do? You use your shield to cover the most part of your body possible, which is that it is not that. If the arrows are coming from that side, great, but if they're coming from all around, you've got to do that. The second point that I'd like to talk about is the use of rawhide. Now there is a fantastic book out there, which from my point of view is unfortunately only in German. And that book is this. It is a fantastic book, and it goes through quite clearly, even though I don't speak German, the history of shields, the construction of them, how to replicate them, all the different ways, how the boards are made up, how the rawhide's laid on, or the fabric, or the gesso, or the painting, how the strapping is done. Brilliant book. If you're in shields, get it. But a lot of people have been saying, use rawhide on your shield. What I would say is, I've made a shield which is just representative of many that were in the period, made in many different ways, of many standards, many thicknesses, and so on. When we talk of rawhide, I'm sure many of the shields did have thick rawhide like this, sort of dog chew rawhide. Thick, hard stuff. Or it could have been in thin, parchment-grade rawhide, like this one. And actually, if you look at the pictures, and you look at the way the material is peeling away where it's broken, you can see it's really very thin on the whole. So I don't think that's such a big deal to get hung up about on that one.
Hi, we're back at the range now. First up is 25 metres, so we're going to run through type 7s, type 9s, M2s. No barbed ones on this one because I'm bored of having to pull them out of targets. And we're going to measure the speed and then calculate the energy and see what we've got. 25 metres. Type 7 needle bodkin. So I think I'm going to go for another 7 a bit higher. I'd like to see how it behaves. My shooting is leaving a little to be desired. I think that's just about got the beef. Right, so we're going to go on to type 9s, which are the short bodkins. It's sighted in a little left actually, so I'm having to compensate for that. It's going to make it interesting at the longer distances. Maybe not. That went exactly where I was pointing it. Now we're onto the M2s. There's not going to be a lot left of the shield by the end of it. Faster. You can see that's faster. I hit with all 9 of them. Only one, which was one of the type 7s needles, went into the beef in the mail. So let's undo and we'll have a look what we got. So what I'm expecting to see, judging by that head, is that the needle has gone through the male and the gambeson. And there we go, straight in. It's not the string, it is the male itself is jamming up on the Type 7. It's just sort of, there we go. As you can see, that one there, that was straight through the male and the gambeson to about 45 millimeter depth. So you've got 10 mil of gambeson, so 5 mil of male. So around about 30 millimeters into the arm. So that Type 7 needle bodkin at 25 meters went through two layers of linen, 15 mil of poplar, three layers of wool, 32 layers of linen, one layer of male, and about 30 millimeters into a beef joint. There's some power there. I could snap these off, I'm sure, if I was in a battle situation. But you know, one of those things, as they say about whether you can shoot arrows back, well, even the ones that are in the ground, you can shoot back if the heads haven't gone or nobody's trampled them. Here we go again. So this is the 50 meter mark. Okay, significantly low, but we will get an arrow speed off that. Right, rubbish shooting on my part, but I've corrected now, so hopefully the other ones are going to start getting closer. So we'll carry on. It's also remembering the different weights, because of course, they're significantly different weights. Yes. So that's a short bodkin strike on the shield. Oh, just over. Now with the M2s. Now these are lighter again. Rubbish, there you go. That's why I've got the backstops. At 50 meters, quite clearly I only got two strikes on the shield. But that one, to give you an idea, there you go. So it's pretty much a hand span, which looks to be about 14 centimeters, something like that. And there's about 5 centimeters here, so sort of 2 inches off. So that's the M2, which is lighter, so it's carrying less momentum and less energy. That might be it, might be the arrowhead shape, don't know. This is quite a heavy one. It's the second heaviest of our head types, the short bodkin. Good arrows these by Will Sherman. They don't fall apart easily. I've removed the scope off this thing. I'm an open sights kind of a guy and it was not good for my karma. So here we go. Oh, just under. But the thing is, mostly at this distance, I'd like a shield hit, but mostly I'm trying to get a speed reading. So these are the Type 7s, which are the heaviest of my shafts. Yes! Short bodkins, Type 9s. Ugh, rubbish. Right, fingers crossed for the last of these. Ugh, fell short. We're not going to find out about Type 9. M2s. These are fast. Yes. So we should be able to get an angle register for those as well. Rubbish. Anyway, so we're back with our shield now. Only two strikes on here, an M2 and a needle bodkin Type 7. Poplar, great wood for a shield. It is a centimetre from the edge and it has not broken away. The whole shield has still held there. And, you know, it's still hard to get the arrow out. So the oak just would have blown away if that had hit it there. Ash probably would have held up, I think, but it's heavy. Now, what is interesting, and here is our needle bodkin, our Type 7, and it has hit onto the beef. Oh, it does jam in. And still, there's about 30 millimeters of needle bodkin poking out the back. So at 75 meters, this has gone through four layers of linen canvas, three layers of wool, 15 mil of poplar, 32 layers of linen, one layer of mail, and 25 millimeters, 1 inch of flesh. That's not bad. Here we are, out at 100 meters. I'm going to try and get a speed reading. Hopefully I'll even get one on the target. First up, Type 7s, the needle bodkins. Yeah, excellent. Just top of target. So we got speed off that, if nothing else. Type 9s now. Bit short. M2s, bit faster, so I've got to be a bit cautious with these. Don't want to send them over. And last arrow for today. So let's go and have a look what we got. I didn't manage to hit the shield at 100 metres, but I did hit the framework that was holding it. So that's 50 millimetres, 2 inches, of building grade spruce. And you can see what the arrows are doing to that at 100 metres. So what are they going to do to you if you haven't got armour on? But we're going to go back and have a look at the tables and see how much energy this has lost or gained, who knows, by travelling this distance. So back to conclude our Joules Mark II. What was really notable was that the needle bodkin, the Type 7, at both 25 metres and at 75 metres, I managed to get that to go through the shield and the arm assembly behind it, so the gambeson and the mail. So at 75 metres certainly, the arm is still compromised by a needle bodkin going through that. Now one thing also to note about the shield is that this has had 20 strikes on it, 12 mil half inch holes right the way through, and it is still, 21 actually, I forgot the one on the side, absolutely a viable defence. I've jumped back into this film a few days later, hence the t-shirt change, because I put together a table of data. I'll show you that in a minute, but it's also in the notes. But what is interesting about that table of data is it tells us that the arrows lose velocity over distance. So at 100 metres, they're losing between 15 and 20% of the velocity, which is really useful and great to know. And that's something that I didn't know before. I didn't have any kind of a number, a figure on it. So that's really useful. However, under my figures, the Type 7, the heaviest, loses more velocity than the lightest, the M2. And that doesn't make any sense to me. So it could be an error in my measurement because I was frame counting the last 10 meters on a slow-mo camera, and there's always going to be a little bit of error in that. It could be that there's something going on I don't understand. So, you know, come back, tell us what's going on if you know what's going on. But the bottom line is that we now know between 15 and 20% of the velocity of any given arrow type is lost at the 100 meter point off an English warbow. I'll put up the data table now. And then when you see me again, I'll be in my old t-shirt with my rust red look, and we'll carry on with the rest of the film. Now this is completely counterintuitive to me. I do not get it, because the needle bodkin is the heaviest, and I would imagine that it would maintain its momentum better than the others, because drag is going to have more of an effect on the lighter objects. So what the hell is going on? I really don't know. What can I say? Those are the numbers I got. And there you go. That's arrow speeds combined with shooting the shield again, just for the heck of it. So watch out for the next Lockdown Longbow, because who knows what it's going to be? There's so much left to do. We've got arrows underwater, we have got brigandines, we might revisit the gambeson again, plate, of course, boiled leather. There's just so much left. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed it.